Every pitch for an agricultural startup or project begins with the same statistic and emphasis. The population is growing rapidly, and we will need to feed 10 billion people by 2050. This is great. It's a big, hairy, audacious goal that the entire industry, the entire world, can get behind. But right now, it's not clear that we can achieve our goal. If you spend enough time talking to people in agriculture, development, or impact investing, you'll get the idea that nothing is working. If you talk to someone in agricultural finance, they'll tell you how just 14% of rural Zambians are formally banked. If you talk to someone focused on productivity, they'll tell you how smallholders are producing just 20% per hectare of what commercial farmers in Zambia are producing. Above all, you'll hear about poverty. You'll hear how rural poverty rates haven't changed in four decades, how in 1980 the rural poverty rate was 80%. In 2019, 78%. Every time, the picture painted is one of struggle and suffering and, above all, scale. Hopeless, endless scale. 10 billion people to feed. 821 million currently going to bed hungry on any given night. 1.6 billion overfed. 750 million in poverty. Trillions of dollars have been spent in the broad field of agricultural development in the last 60 years. We all share the same mission of ensuring that we can feed the future, and yet we're still here. I'm convinced that the major problem facing agricultural development today is an absolute obsession with scale. The prioritization of the number of farmers reached over the depth to which we engage them has brought us to where we are today. Trillions in investment wasted, billions of people out of balance and unsatisfied, and millions in a seemingly endless cycle of poverty. Clearly, all of us rushing to feed 10 billion people are doing something wrong. There's an expression, most often credited to Desmond Tutu, that I love. There is only one way to eat an elephant, one bite at a time. In other words, no matter the size of the challenge, if you break it into bite-sized pieces, you can achieve it. Those driving the agenda today in agricultural development are trying to live by this maxim. But they have no table manners. Their bites are way too big. As an agricultural entrepreneur and a social entrepreneur, I can't count the number of times that I've been told, if your model can't reach a million people, it doesn't matter. To which I reply, doesn't matter to who? Those living by the million-person gospel are mistaking large numbers for long-term thinking. Unintentionally, they are encouraging the proliferation of what I call disposable solutions. Short-term, light-touch, single-issue products, projects, or services that reach many, yet truly affect few. They scale, but they do little, if anything, to address the root causes of why these solutions were needed in the first place. We must change the dominant thinking in development to the prioritization of depth of engagement over number of people reached. Because in truth, long-term thinking is taking the time to build the foundations and invest fully in the farmers who will feed us all. I grew up on a farm in the northwest of the United States. When I return to farm someday, I will be a fourth-generation steward of that land. My great-grandfather pioneered the farm. This is him, the young man in the overalls, looking pretty handsome. My grandfather followed in his footsteps. and my father after him. My cousin is there now, continuing the family profession. When my grandfather began farming, the primary source of power for preparing the land was horses. By the time he stopped farming 90 years later, the farm had 500 horsepower tractors that could steer themselves. This change didn't happen overnight. It took generations. And when I relocated to Zambia, although this may sound different than a typical smallholding, what struck me was that the similarities are actually far more profound. Farmers all over the world, whether on 5 acres in Zambia or 5,000 acres in the United States, ask the same 5 key questions every year. What am I going to grow? Where am I going to get the inputs? How will I pay for it? How do I get a good yield? And who am I going to sell to? Understanding these questions and how farmers answer them in a given context is what agricultural companies are built on. In order for farmers to grow from horses to horsepower, companies must grow alongside them. At home, when we have a pest attack our crop, we have agronomists that we can reach out to for identification and recommendations on control. When the farm needs financing, there are institutions that we can engage that know my family, their wants, what they're working for, and what they're capable of. Most farmers in Zambia are facing a very different reality. After decades of disposable solutions, in rural areas there are no banks, few service providers, limited storage infrastructure. Roads are terrible, farmers have no address or credit profiles, and connectivity to internet and even cellular service is often non-existent. So in 2014, my co-founders and I started our company, Good Nature Agro, to be a full farm partner to smallholders in Zambia. To be one organization that the farmers could come to for answers to any or all of their questions throughout the seasons. Every farmer who grows for Good Nature has access to high-value markets in legume seeds or commodity. Every farmer receives a fair, secure, and transparent contract. Every farmer has access to training and advice through our network of private extension agents, lead farmers who are incentivized by revenue share in the company. Every farmer has access to inputs that are increasingly customized to their fields and production histories. And they have access to financing to make these inputs accessible. At the end of the season, every farmer can receive a premium price when they deliver quality product. This model delivers results. When we started working with farmers, baseline net grower income per hectare was $113. Our long-term average is $357 net grower income per hectare. This year, with favorable rains and continued improvements on the model, our farmers are averaging more than $600 net income per hectare. How many of you want to farm now? We're proud of what we've built, but we're also aware that we are just one part in a growing ecosystem of support. And this is where it gets hard. Because if we are to achieve our goal, if we're to feed 10 billion people by 2050, we will need the many to work together. To illustrate what is possible, I'm going to introduce you to a farm and a farmer. Her name is Anis Tembo. In the scale-driven model, Anis will always remain a number, a phone number, a national registration number, one of 1,000 or 50,000 or 1,000,000. But we've worked together for 5 years, and Anis is a hell of a farmer. Year after year, she's proven her productivity and reliability, all while supporting 40 of her peers as a private extension agent with Good Nature. There are many agribusinesses that want to work with Anis, but there are no systems, no visibility, on which farmers, like her, are ready for more, more contracts, more financing, more investment, and which farmers are just beginning on their journey. Individually, organizations are trying to close this knowledge gap. Over the past several years, Good Nature has invested heavily in mapping farmers' fields, establishing credit scores with each of our growers, transitioning to digital payments and savings, even establishing expanded internet access and access to phones. These are different from investing in financing farmers or logistics. Those are annual costs that will recur time and time again. These are foundational investments designed to improve how we can engage with Anna and her offspring over decades. We're not the only ones making these investments. We're definitely not the only ones investing in annual services with farmers like Anna's. That's the point, and that's the problem. A complete lack of collaboration and coordination across the industry has made for remarkably inefficient investments and has caused many organizations to throw up their hands and say it is too hard and too expensive to engage small farmers in the deep rural areas. But let's go deeper. Anna's farms on 3 hectares. On 1 hectare, she's contracted to produce soybean seed with Good Nature. 2 other common value chains where she operates are maize and cotton. On this 1 hectare, she'll engage with Good Nature on those same core services in the model we've already discussed. If we have any margin left over, we'll invest in the foundations. Our entire view of Anna's right now comes from this 1 hectare. In the next field over, also Anna's field, another company, a cotton company, will make many of the same investments. They're also assisting Anna's in addressing her 5 key questions, but on a different crop and a different field. The inefficiencies are compounding. And in the third field, Anna's final field, maize, it's a completely different story. She is almost entirely unsupported. Markets are open, buyers may come or they may not. If financing becomes available, it will be because a project decides to implement it for a short period of time. It'll come when the project comes, and it'll go when the project goes. The incentives to work together are obvious. We must begin to collaborate on the annual costs if we are to ever establish the foundations. Because when we work alone, we all learn to deal with the challenges of engaging smallholder farmers, the distance, the roads, the lack of visibility. But when we work together, we can solve those challenges. Earlier this year, Good Nature commissioned the build of a digital platform. It's an opportunity for shared investment through shared information. It's going to be really cool, and it uses some impressive technology, but the technology is not the solution. The collaboration is. It's a place where all of the agribusinesses who engage Anna's, all of the agribusinesses and other stakeholders who want to engage Anna's, and most importantly, Anna's herself, can come together to connect. Where we can identify where efficiencies can be gained, and where we can all afford to invest more deeply. If and when multiple companies bring their currently narrow credit profiles together, we can get a holistic financial view of the farm, Anna's farm, for the first time. And Anna's is well on her way to being banked. If and when we can agree upon and implement methods for moving to digital payments and savings, we can use the information that's captured to steer other stakeholders, like telecommunication companies, to where they should invest in rural areas. And Anna's is well on her way to being connected. Together, we can have a depth of information that currently feels out of reach. We can preserve margins and reset our relationship with farmers in such a way that the farmers can, many for the first time, see a viable path to their long-term financial goals. We can afford to we can afford to start investing in farmers like people again. Annual success comes from answering the five questions with farmers and answering them well. But there is a sixth question, the most important question that farmers all over the world ask. What do I want? What am I working for? When we ask farmers what they want to achieve, what their financial goals are across 5 years, the answers range widely. Many want to invest deeper in their farms. They want to purchase assets like motorcycles and trucks and tractors. Some want to move to the city to take a job or to start another business. Nearly everyone talks about education for their children and ensuring that the next generation has a choice of whether they farm or not. These are middle-class goals. But who hears them? Who works for them? This question is a health check for our entire system. If you're an organization who, like us, is built around engaging smallholder farmers, do you have someone on your staff who knows what every farmer you engage is working for? Probably not. The way systems are built right now, it's very, very hard to do. But can we all agree that this is how a healthy system should function? That we all want to be treated as individuals, not as insignificant because of the size of our operations. We don't have multiple generations to achieve our goal of feeding 10 billion people. We have one generation. And in front of us, we have two alternate 2050s. We could continue to focus on scale. We could continue to prioritize the number of farmers reached over the depth to which we engage them. We could continue to roll out disposable solutions and give ourselves the illusion of change as we engage many, yet affect few. Or we could slow down. We can take the time to invest in the foundations right now. The foundations that will allow the solutions that we already have, as well as solutions we haven't dreamed of yet, to effectively engage farmers no matter where they are over the coming decades. We can prioritize depth of engagement over scale because we know that a supported farmer is a successful farmer. Which will we choose? Thank you. Thank you.